voice creation sprang at once to sight. All the angel faces and all the hosts of light, thrones and dominations, stars upon their way. All the heavenly order in the great array, they sing glory to the Lord on high. Glory to the Son who came to earth to die. Glory to the Spirit who lifts the name on high. The name of Jesus, the name of Jesus, at the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus.
Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Happy Daylight Saving Sunday, one of my favorite days of the year, but not everybody feels that way, which reminds me, good morning to those of you who are on live stream. I think we have a few extra people on live stream who maybe slept a little bit late, but it's great to have everyone tuning in and everyone here. I'm going to open in prayer and then share some announcements with you. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can gather together around your word and in your presence, wherever we may be, to worship the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who love us so much and together have carried out the plan of salvation. Receive our worship today, encourage our hearts, and strengthen our faith in our time together. As we worship you, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Tammy is not here, but I will do my best to go through the announcements. We have meetings in March that you are invited to if you wish to go. All our meetings at the Union Church are open to anybody who wishes to come. Finances tomorrow night at 6:30. Trustees are Tuesday at 11. You are invited. We're also doing donations. Jeff Kay has a connection to a women's sober house that really has a lot of needs. It's in Millbury, Mass, called Roads to Recovery. So we are collecting items that they gave us on a list that would be useful for them. They're due by April 2nd if you wish to participate. And there's also an email that went out. The email newsletter has information about that. And I know a lot of people donate to that. We filled more than we needed to in a week before Christmas. So thank you in advance for your service. Men's breakfast is this coming Saturday, 8:30 to 10 a.m. The food is great. The fellowship is great. All men are invited. On April 6th at 7 p.m., we'll have one of our somber services of the year. Maundy Thursday is the night of the Last Supper. John chapters 14 through 17, Gospel of John. And it's a reflection on the suffering of Jesus out of love for us. So you are invited to put that on your calendar and take part in that. And on Easter, which is April 9, we will be gathered to worship here. And in your bulletin, I didn't get one in my bulletin, but there are little invitation cards if you'd like to pray about who you might want to invite to come for Easter Sunday. Easter is one of the two biggest times of the year that people feel inclined to go to church, Easter and Christmas. So we're asking if people could pray about who they'd like to invite, and you have invitation cards available to give out, and there are extras on each of the tables at each of our entrances, so you're invited to do that. I believe now we are going to stand and sing together in worship from all of our heart to the Lord.
Jesus is calling. Thank you.
grateful for our worship team. If you don't know this, they arrive at like 7:30 in the morning, and they're here for the 8 o'clock service. And for some of them, that was a real sacrifice today with an hour of sleep gone. So very grateful for them. Grateful for that we may worship our Lord together and give him our praise. We always take a moment in our service to pray for some of the needs that are shared with us or are on our hearts. If you're watching this morning and you just happen to tune in and you ever have a prayer request, just Google the Union Church in Foxborough. That's where we are, Foxborough, Mass, and feel free to send in your prayer request. I got a text a moment ago from Maxine McIntosh. Ted and Maxine were hoping to be with us this morning. Felt it was maybe a week too early, so they are not here, but we're grateful to know they are watching and many others as well. And we will pray for some of the needs in our church family, including every now and then we get live stream viewers who send in a prayer request, so we may or may not recognize the names, but they are part of our church family. Psalm 107 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures for how long? Forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say this, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe, those he gathered from the land, from the east and west, the north and south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight path to a city where they could settle. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love, for his wonderful deeds for men. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things." Heavenly Father, we are grateful to come before you today. And we don't take it for granted that this is just another Sunday and we're going through a routine. For we recognize ourselves in Psalm 107. We too wandered in a wasteland. We too were hungry and thirsty. We too at times in our life have felt our life itself ebbing away. And the majority of us, Lord, have had the experience that we cried out to you in our time of trouble and found that you delivered us from our distress and set our feet on a straight path and gave us a place where we could dwell. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for your mercy, which we just sang of a moment ago. Thank you that in a world where we see confusion and we see strife and we see terrible, heart-wrenching violence and people doing incredibly evil things, we may still look to you. We may still find hope in you. And you have promised that one day you will bring human history to an end, and you will banish all that is evil and all that is sinful and all that is wrong in your sight. And evil will be no more. And you will be triumphant through your Son, Jesus Christ, who defeated all evil by his sacrifice on the cross and rose again to demonstrate his victory over sin and death. So thank you for these things. Thank you that every good thing we enjoy in our life is a gift that you have given us. And Father, this morning we continue to pray for some of our ongoing requests and some new requests. Thank you first, Heavenly Father, that we have prayed and prayed for renewal in our country and in a college chapel service at Asbury College in Kentucky. You began a revival and a renewal among the youngest generation, and it is spreading all across this country to Christian and secular campuses. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your goodness. Fan the flame of revival, we pray, that people might know you and have hope in you and understand their eternal value before you. Father, we pray for a man named Mark this morning who has had cancer for 5 years. We pray, Heavenly Father, at this crucial time that your hand might be upon him, that his treatment might for once and forever put away this cancer and he might be well. Bless him, we pray today. Thank you, Father, for George Sirikas, who is with us today in the 10 o'clock service, and we have prayed for him and continue to, that treatment likewise would be effective for his health and well-being, and you might grant him hope and a sense of your love and your grace and your presence to George and to his family. We pray for Hugh and Barbara this morning, online viewers. Father, that you would be with them with the health situations they face, and your Holy Spirit would work in their hearts and lives to heal their bodies, and Father, give them a sense of your love and your grace. For someone in our church family who is battling anxiety, this is a real affliction. Many of us have struggled with it, clinically or situationally. Father, be with this dear person. Grant them comfort. Grant them deliverance. Grant them wellness, we would pray. For a woman named Samantha who is in need of a changed work situation, we pray that you would intervene and you would grant this to her. And we would pray not only would she have an equal job, but a better one. Bless her and her life, that we would pray today. Be with Lorna, who has health issues. Bless her. You know all about her. Bless her. Be with our dear Kelly, who may be watching this morning, with her lung issues. Grant her clear lungs. Grant her blessing and strength, we pray. And for Ted and Maxine, as they continue to walk through Ted's physical therapy and his recovery, Father, grant that you might continue to increase his strength, that they would indeed be with us again very soon. Father, for anyone with an unspoken prayer request this morning, a personal situation shared with very few, but one that is tearing at our heart and soul, Father, work in each of these situations, whether they be a broken relationship in family or with a friend, or it be an economic, a financial situation, or if it's a health scare or a health situation that is uncertain, or whatever it might be, something about a loved one. Father, be with any with an unspoken prayer request, and so work, we pray, that we would see your deliverance, as we read about in Psalm 107. Deliver us in our distress, we pray. Be with our president and those in authority over us. Grant him and them a greater wisdom than human wisdom. Continue to watch over our country, we pray. And as many nations are turning to you around the world, we think of Africa today and Asia, and how millions and billions of people are turning to Christ. May this be true in our own nation as well. And Father, we worship you this morning together as people who call on your name, as Jesus taught his disciples to pray, whose Father? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Invite Fran to come up and say our offering prayer this morning.
Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you on this beautiful day. This is the time in our service that we give thanks and show joy to the Lord for the tithes and offering given in love by our congregation. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, thank you that your promises are sure and you are faithful. We can fully rely on you, dear Lord. The Bible teaches us that we find much joy at giving time and should bring our tithes and offerings to you, and you will bless us. May the love of God reign in our lives and the joy of our relationship with you hold up as always. We pray these things in your precious name. Amen.
Fran's prayer spoke to my heart this morning. I gave a pound of my personal Dunkin' Donuts coffee to our coffee here. I'll find joy in that somehow, giving up a pound of coffee. That's not easy. We're going to be looking this morning in a few moments, about a third of the way through the sermon, actually, at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. If you want to look along in the Bible, in the back of the chair that looks like this, it's page 852 if you're using your phone. It's Hebrews chapter 12, and we'll be looking at verses 1 through 4. How many of you know who Joan Benoit Samuelson is? A few people do. Joan Benoit Samuelson is a native New Englander. She grew up on Cape Elizabeth, Maine, in southern Maine, right on the coast. In college, Joni was a skier, and she began running in the off-season to strengthen her legs. She discovered she was really fast, so she became a competitive runner. By her senior year, only her second year as a competitive runner, she was number one woman runner in the nation. She entered the Boston Marathon because her coach suggested it the next year after college, and in her first time, she broke the women's record, not by a minute or two, by 22 minutes, which is phenomenal. She ran it again the next year. She blew away the competition, beating her own record from the year before by 8 more minutes. She, in 2 years, improved the women's Boston Marathon record by half an hour. Her time, her best time in Boston, was the record that stood for 21 years. Her Chicago Marathon best stood as the Chicago, that's a flat course, really fast. It stood as the Chicago Marathon record 38 years. At the age of 52, Joni made a comeback in Boston. She set a course record for women over 50, coming in fourth place among women. She did it again when she was 55, setting a course record for women over 50. At 60 years old, Joan Samuelson came back and set another record for women not over 60, all women over 50 when she was 60 years of age. She's a phenomenal runner. And she said this, and it's a great quote, "As every runner knows, running is about more than putting one foot in front of another. It's about our very lifestyle and who we are. And every time I fail, I assume I'll come back stronger because of it. I keep on running, literally and figuratively, every day, because for me, there's always a place to go, and it's always urgent to get there. There's always a place to go and a sense of urgency to get there." Well, Joan Benoit Samuelson, who I personally admire as a runner, and the author of Hebrews share the metaphor of running a race, running with a sense of urgency, running with a sense of purpose, if not to win the race, then to give our very best. The author of Hebrews was writing to encourage first century Christians around the Roman Empire who had been under persecution, and the author had summoned up in chapter 11, you may or may not recall, a whole series of faith heroes, the Faith Hall of Fame, heroes from the Old Testament who had endured difficult times, often persecution, yet had persevered to run the race and give it their very best. And before we go into Hebrews chapter 12, I would like to think about another point. I didn't even line up a scripture for it, but I want us to understand one thing about suffering. Because of the way the human mind works and the way we feel about ourselves and the way sometimes people will look at us, so often we attribute suffering to God or to my messing up in some way. And we want to understand as Christian believers, suffering is not necessarily because of our personal sin. In fact, often when we think it is not. The hard times earlier faith heroes mentioned in chapter 11 went through was the result of persecution, the result of being faithful to Elohim, the true God who made all things, and standing out because of their faith in a population that didn't want to hear about a God to whom we would one day be accountable. The majority and the government, the king or whoever, cracking down on the faith of those in the minority who were faithful. And as we look at the Faith Hall of Fame, we see Rahab, who just happened to live in the wrong place at the wrong time. We see Moses, who defied the government of the Pharaoh in Egypt to do God's work in opposition to the king to set the people free. We see Daniel, who was at the upper echelons of the government in the province of Babylon in the Persian Empire for decades, and yet again and again fell into disfavor with some group or another because of his faith as a Hebrew Jew faithful to God in a land of Persia. We see Isaiah, who was referred to in that chapter, not by name, but in experience, cut in half at the end of his life, obviously, due to his many decades of faithful service to God. None were suffering because of what they did, because they did wrong, because they made a mistake, because God was seeking vengeance, because God is vengeful and was punishing them, though often our minds condemn us with the idea that God is against us, or we are worthy of punishment, or God is looking the other way, and that's why we're suffering. Where is God, we ask, in the midst of my suffering? We may have habits that are damaging to our health. We may make foolish decisions in terms of our career. We may get ourselves in a situation when we are young that may have ramifications that go on and on through many decades afterward. These can be self-induced causes of suffering, but none are God's punishment. God does not operate that way. God is not vindictive or vengeful. When we have trouble, when we have difficulty, God may be seeking to get our attention, but he isn't seeking to wreak vengeance or revenge on us. He is not vengeful toward his people. He does not reject us. He does not feel we are less than. Therefore, we are not less than if we are suffering over here and other people over here seem to have a life that's just all perfect in one place. They are not favored by God. He doesn't operate that way. So understanding suffering, our human instinct is to judge ourselves or judge others. Other people will judge us at times, often harshly, condemning ourselves, thinking God has forgotten us, God is against us, God is punishing me. But the suffering in Hebrews comes because we are faithful, because some were faithful. Suffering does not mean God is against us ever. For God so loved you that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So we're learning to look at suffering biblically, and today we're looking specifically at persecution. And Danny is going to read for us our text, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 4.
Good morning. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that is so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood.
Danny, so this passage uses the analogy of running, as we opened with this morning. And the point it makes first is we are to run the race of faith like our heroes did. We're to run all out and give it our best as our heroes in the previous chapter listed for us also did. Remember being a kid and you were in a foot race? Maybe you never were, I was. And you ran as hard as you could to beat that other kid to see who would have bragging rights as being faster. That's how we're to run. Or if you think of the analogy of Joan Benoit Samuelson and running long distance, you think of someone gliding along at a steady speed, mile after mile, at a comfortable, fast pace, up over hills, around curves, maybe on a trail through the woods, running a steady speed, time after time, mile after mile. The author was saying, run that type of race. Run consistently. Run to give it your very best, spiritually speaking. And we have a great cloud of witnesses, it says, to look at. And their history is all around us. And that includes the state of Massachusetts, by the way. There are great historical sites in our state of Christians who have gone before, who ran the race successfully. Therefore, we're to emulate these people. The author means the people in Hebrews chapter 11, who ran in spite of persecution, difficulty, and all sorts of things that they faced. We're to emulate them. We're to cast aside, the author says, anything that holds us back, anything that hinders us from running our very race, very best race. Run with endurance. Run mile after mile. It's a great feeling to glide along the road or the trail in good shape, steadily as you go. That's how we're to run the race, the author of Hebrews is saying. One thing you don't want if you're actually running a distance is you don't want a sweatshirt. You don't, unless it's really cold out, do not wear a sweatshirt. A sweatshirt will hold in the moisture. I'll use the word moisture. Your body is producing. It holds it in. It becomes clammy, and then the wind goes right through you. If you want a free sweatshirt, or as many as you could ever need in your entire life, go to Hopkinton in the Patriots Day in April and stand at the starting line or for the first few hundred yards, sweatshirts all the way as runners throw them to the side. Don't let anything hinder you. Don't let anything hinder you. You don't want loose shoes so that you develop blisters or things that will hinder the race. What's the analogy, the meaning of that. You don't want to be a person who has a dirty little secret over here that as a Christian you're hanging on to and nobody else knows about and you aren't accountable to, and you're doing this thing or you have this thing over here that you know is contrary to what God would want. You don't want to have a thing like that to hinder you. You don't want to be the person who gets in the habit of telling a little lie and that leads to another lie, and pretty soon you're lying all the time. You don't want to be hindered by being inconsistent. One person over here with my church friends, a completely different person over here with my work friends or my other friends. We want to be consistent. Whatever is hindering us, we want to throw it away and not have it, because we want to run the race successfully and regularly. We want to run toward certain things also. We want to run toward getting on our knees when our day begins and spending some time with the one who will guide us through our day, if only we will ask him. We want to run to him in prayer. When we have difficulty or heartache, we'll have already developed the habit we need to run to him who has all the answers and all the wisdom. We want to run to the Word of God on a daily basis. We want to spend some time in it. And I recommend early in the morning, even on Daylight Saving Sunday, so that our day is set by Scripture, and maybe we even put it in our phone, in our notes, and every now and then through our day, we look at a Scripture or we remember a Scripture because it guides us. We run toward those things so that we can run the race through our day, through the next hour, through today, through tomorrow, piece by piece. We're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, people who lived before us, whose faithful example we can follow, and remembering this and honoring them and following after them will keep us in the place we should be as we run our race in whatever time God gives us. I mentioned a couple weeks ago when I was a new pastor and still finishing seminary, I was 2 years left in seminary when I became pastor here. A prominent local pastor fell into a moral scandal. He was married to this woman and he had a relationship that he shouldn't have with another woman. And I was young enough then that I was shocked to hear this. I wish I could still say that today, but I was shocked to hear this, and it made an impression on me. I never wanted my name on that list. I never wanted my name on the humiliating list of pastors who fell due to some type of moral scandal. And I deliberately kept in close touch as a young pastor with Wilbert Lind and Dr. Leslie B. Flynn, my mentors, and I studied them and I listened to them and I observed them because I wanted, if not as capable as them, I wanted to be like them and follow their example. And Billy Graham was a great role model for me to follow. And I examined my heart and I determined in my heart I did not want to go near trouble. I wanted to run in the middle of the herd, not on the edge. I didn't want my name on that list in any way. I have people say to me, and this isn't meant to be an offense to anyone, but I have people say to me all the time, you remember the movie, remember that movie? No. No, I don't, because I avoid them. I don't need that one scene that will get things in my heart and mind that shouldn't be there. I want to run in the middle of the herd. I want to run the race clean. I want to run the race in the way that is advised here. We're to run the race to win for this hour, for the next hour, till noon, till this afternoon. Paul used the same analogy, and maybe that's where the author of Hebrews got it, over in 1 Corinthians 9, when he wrote, do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? This is before the day when everybody got a trophy. Only one gets the prize. Run in such a way that you get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man who beats the air, meaning for no purpose. I beat my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I will not be disqualified from the prize myself. The analogy is like an athlete working hard to be in shape, to run the race, and it's applied spiritually to us. We don't all have to go running up the street, but spiritually we want to be fit. We want to be ready. We want to be in the right place. We want to run the spiritual race to win. And that's the advice given in Hebrews chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. And it may mean really thinking about what I'm doing, what I'm spending my time on, what pulls my heart and mind in the wrong direction. If my computer pulls my heart and mind the wrong way, junk it. Spend less time on it. Put restrictions, controls, whatever it is. It might be less distraction by lesser things. Maybe I don't need the news on or the newspaper. I gave up reading the newspaper first thing because I wanted to read the Word of God and not be distracted as I was. And trust me, if anyone in this room or watching on live stream is easily distracted, it is Bill Dudley. So run the race to win. And then the second emphasis of this little passage is on a very unique phrase that's found nowhere else in the pages of Scripture, and it says our target. It says, fix your eyes on Jesus. And the wording in verse 2 is unique in all the pages of the Bible, the wording where it says, fix your eyes. That's nowhere else in Scripture. Fix your eyes, literally in the Greek, do not look away from Jesus. Do not look away. Always look to him as the target, the guide, the example. Being in the immediate presence of an object we may gaze at. I remember being in Washington, D.C. It might have been the Smithsonian. And I think it was the Hope Diamond. And it was like big as a half dollar, and it was blue. It was the color of my shirt. It was beautiful. And I remember staring at it, and I remember thinking, you know, it's in a plastic case. If I had a hammer, I could be instantly arrested. But you move on. You move on. You don't stand staring at the Hope Diamond or the Lincoln Memorial or the Washington Monument, whatever you're at, wherever you are. You get distracted by lesser things. The second piece of information given here is fix your eyes on Jesus. Don't look away. Don't be distracted. Why is Jesus called the author of our faith, the beginner of our faith? Because he is personally and theologically. It's Jesus who inspired the Old Testament. Jesus who walked with our first parents in the Garden of Eden. It's he who authors our salvation, not just by giving his life on the cross, but by working with the Father and the Holy Spirit to prepare the way for his coming to the cross. He is personally the one who sends the Holy Spirit to work in our lives, which is why we end up with a spiritual curiosity. I remember when I began to have, a spiritual curiosity and feel an emptiness. That's the Holy Spirit working in our life so that we would one day trust in him. And he is the author, the worker, and the completer of our faith, because in him, when we believe in him, and his Holy Spirit comes to live in us at that moment, we are complete, and we are complete again in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus is the end-all and be-all of our faith. Heroes of faith mentioned in the Faith Hall of Fame, Hebrews 11, Enoch and Moses and Abraham and Rahab and all of them. are only tiny flickers in comparison with the glory of Jesus. So the author says, here are a crowd of witnesses. They, as humans, did what you can do, but keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Like I tell the same stories over and over and about the same people over and over, so forgive this, but I'm sorry, Tiger Woods. You aren't the golfer who drew the biggest crowds in history. That was Arnold Palmer. Arnie's Army was a thing. United Airlines for a while advertised as Arnie's Air Force. They were a massive group of people who followed him everywhere he went. I've been in it. I was in it years ago. One time, you may recall this story, Arnie is on a certain tee, and as he's walking off after hitting his tee shot, he notices a little boy crying, maybe five or six years old. And he's a dad, and I've witnessed him being kind to a child. And he said to the little boy, why are you crying? I can't find my parents. And Arnie stuck out that big bare paw of a hand that he had and said, take my hand. You come with me. Your parents will find you if you come with me. And they walked up the middle of the fairway, and sure enough, from a crowd on one side, the voice of a frantic set of parents was, over here, over here. And the little boy went scampering off to his parents. Stay with Arnie, you'll be seen, you'll be found. Jesus says, look at me. Take my hand. Follow me. You'll be found. I, Jesus, can show you how to live life. I can show you, if you let me, how to have a better life in this world so that everyone around you who you influence will also have a better life because you chose to come with me. And I can show you how to do life, and at the end of it, if you're trusting in me, I can give you eternity in the kingdom of heaven. Take my hand. You'll be found. You'll find your way. Follow me. Hebrews reminds us of the most important things in life. And if you're like me, I'm easily distracted. I want to know about this little town up somewhere in Maine. I want to know about this person or this event in history. I'm fascinated by different people groups and how they live and why they do and what they believe. Hebrews says, we suffer not because God is seeking vengeance against us or necessarily because we made a mistake. It's a fallen world. And sometimes we'll suffer because we're a follower of Jesus Christ. But when we do, persevere. And in the hard times or the good times, and the good times can be more spiritually dangerous, when we aren't forced to get on our knees, in the good times or the hard times, run the race. Run with intent. Run to win. Run with all you have. Throw away the sweatshirt. Throw away the old pair of shoes. Whatever hinders, run. Go forward. Run as hard as you can toward the prize in the kingdom of heaven that will be yours. And the finish line, where we keep our eyes, is Jesus. He is our goal. He is the one whose arms are outstretched that we're running toward. He is the prize we receive at the end of the race. Fix your eyes on Jesus, Hebrews says. There's no other hero, not even Joni, not even Arnold Palmer, who's worthy of our undivided attention. He will give our life purpose. He will show us how to live life and what to do and how to overcome. He will give us value and allow us to feel valued by the love of a God who made us. He will fix our mess and clean up behind us and make a way before us. And He will bring us safely home. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word and this analogy of running the race in the pages of Hebrews. We thank you that life is compared to a race. And if we fix our eyes on the one, only one who is worthy, and if we run the race to give it our best, you will deliver us. You will lead us. You will give us a better life, even in the trouble and turmoil of this world. And one day, we will be triumphantly in your presence, the kingdom of heaven, forever and ever. Father, I pray for everyone here and everyone watching that you would give us the courage to cast aside any hindrance, to run the race with you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
If you'll stand and sing with us, please.
Today. Thank you to all of you who joined us on live stream. I'm really capable of big mistakes. I've made plenty in my life. But I'm not wrong when I tell you this. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Trust him even if it makes no sense sometimes. And run the race of faith in him to win. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be yours in abundance. Amen.
Yeah, like, yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, like,